Good evening and welcome to Time Chris Parnell.
Reporting from Moscow.
Tbilisi.
Times Square.
May your dreams be your only boundaries in life.
Hello and welcome to this week's edition of GHS TV's award-winning talk show, Crosstalk. I'm your host, Ranimi Mam. Each week in this time slot, we take a look at different issues, personalities, and events that affect you and our community. Independent filmmaking requires not only a good script, but passion and support. This week, we'll be focusing on local film festivals and the support they give to independent filmmakers. Later, we'll be joined by representative from On Location Memphis, as well as independent filmmakers Chris McKinley and Melissa Sweezy. But first, let's take a look at Indie Memphis.
Indie Memphis as an experience is fantastic because not only are there so many great films that you can see here, but it also, you know, it really highlights the best aspects of Memphis itself.
And it works as a kind of introduction to a community of people who are interested in the same kind of things.
I'll get to see all the films that I actually want to see, and I can actually plan my days, you know, accordingly.
All those things come together and create this really great environment. And ultimately, the best thing about it is that it's inspiring to come and be in such a nurturing community.
There's a sense of pride, a real sense of pride here. And it's great to be able to celebrate our movies here in this great town.
So there's something in Memphis that no other city has. And to experience it, not just through the films, but through the activity at night and stuff, is just a great thing.
Joining me now is Ryan Watt, Executive Director of Indie Memphis. Thank you so much for coming on the show today.
Absolutely.
The Indie Film Festival was earlier this month. How did it go?
It went great. We had the largest attendance we've ever had in 18 years.
The feedback that you get from the festival goers is remarkable. Some of the comments read, "Indie Memphis has a good-natured urgency and freewheeling ingenuity most festivals can rarely pull off." How do you continue to make the festival new and interesting each year?
Well, I think that mainly comes from the films. I mean, we're looking for, you know, unique creative voices, and so we get thousands of submissions, and we always see things we've never seen before. So usually just by nature of showing these films and bringing in filmmakers from all over the country, a lot of people come from New York and LA and other areas, as well as the region, you know, Birmingham and Nashville and Atlanta. So just kind of getting everyone there in one place creates a lot of synergy, and hopefully people enjoy it.
Well, we're talking about the festival goers, but let's focus on the filmmakers. Your festival's motto is promote, develop, enrich. How does Indie Memphis use those attributes to support the filmmakers?
Well, we promote by showcasing their work. So a lot of the times it's the first time their films have been seen in front of an audience. We help develop by, we have a grants program that we, last year we gave out $16,000 of cash and cash equivalent rentals so people could make four short films. Last year we did the same thing. We have a monthly series called Shoot and Splice that gives free panel workshops to artists. And then I think the last one was Inspire. So hopefully by them being at the festival and meeting other filmmakers that have been successful through panels and just networking, they're inspired to do something even greater with their next work.
Mr. Watt, what sets Indie Memphis apart from bigger festivals like Sundance?
Well, I mean, we usually use the term we're a regional festival. So there's festivals like Sundance that take the lead, I guess you could say, on premiering some of the biggest films across the country. We are often the first time those films are seen in Memphis. On the other hand, we help discover a lot of filmmakers that are in our region that maybe don't have a film that's one of the few that makes it into Sundance, but still need that support to get seen.
So do some of the films move on to national festivals?
They do. I'd say more likely what happens is we might show work from a filmmaker, and then that helps them get their next film into an even larger festival.
Although independent filmmakers want the public to see their work, do you think that some filmmakers prefer more local or regional festivals rather than national festivals?
I think everyone's striving to get into that national festival. The reality is tens of thousands of submissions are sent and a handful of movies are selected. So there's not room for every filmmaker to play at Sundance. So I think regional festivals like ours are important. We're still picking the best of the best of our region and beyond.
Considering that you just got out of this year's festival, have you already started preparations for next year?
We have, yeah. It never ends. We're already working on the 2016 details. So.
Well, you've had a lot of special appearances at these festivals. Mm-hmm. This year you had Judy Becker, who was the set designer for Carol. Do these appearances bring more public interest to the festival?
Yeah, definitely. It's one thing to show a movie like Carol weeks before it's out, but to have the Oscar-nominated production designer there, be able to ask, answer questions, is really incredible. But then filmmakers are meeting her, and you just never know what connections might lead to future work.
Do they have an opportunity to speak about their work?
Oh, yeah. She spoke afterwards in a Q&A and was also scheduled for a panel about how to fulfill a director's vision.
Do the filmmakers that enter the contest, how do filmmakers enter the contest?
So we have what's called a call for entries. So about April of 2016 is when it will be open for people to submit short films, feature films. We'll also take music video submissions. All ages can submit, and then that goes through about August or so, and then we make our selections, and then the festival will be in November again of 2016.
Well, it was a pleasure having you on the show, Mr. Watt.
Thanks for having me.
We're going to take a short break and leave you with a look at the movies from this year's Indie Memphis Festival. When we return, we'll chat with independent filmmakers Chris McKinley and Melissa Sweezy. Welcome back. Before we left, we had the chance to talk with Executive Director of Indie Memphis, Ryan Watt. But we're not only focusing on film festivals, we're also talking with independent filmmakers themselves. We were able to chat with Chris McKinley earlier this week and ask him about a few of his award-winning films. We began by talking about one of those films, the documentary All Day and All Night. It recently saw success at the Indie Memphis Film Festival. We wanted to know how Mr. McKinley got involved in the project. Here's what he had to say.
All Day and All Night is a documentary about Beale Street. It's about Memphis music, and it has interviews with B.B. King and Rufus Thomas and a lot of other Memphis musicians.
I didn't think of Memphis as Memphis. I thought of Beale Street as Memphis. I've been downhearted, baby.
Well, Beale Street was the black man's haven. That's When you went to Beale Street, if you had problems or troubles or something away from there, once you got to Beale Street, no problem, no trouble. And I told a white fella once, I said, hey, man, if you were black for one Saturday night and on Beale Street, never would you want to be white again.
It was actually made in 1990, and so for the film's 25th anniversary, we remastered it in HD and created a new soundtrack album to go along with it. I got involved because I've been a volunteer for a lot of years for the Center for Southern Folklore in downtown Memphis, and they have a big archive of film and Southern art and culture. We went back to the original 16mm negative that it was shot on and retransferred that in high definition. And it's also sort of an ongoing project. We're adding a lot of extra content to a new website that exists now. So I'd encourage any music fan to go to alldayandallnight.com and check out the stuff that we've got up there. There's a lot of extra footage of B.B. King, Rufus Thomas, and others singing, performing, and talking about Beale Street. So it's been a lot of fun to be involved in.
Heard somebody knocking on my back door. Just about the break of day.
Not only have you received local recognition, but Finding Vivian Maier, another documentary you worked on, was nominated for an Oscar.
Yeah, Finding Vivian Maier was a project I felt really lucky to have been a part of.
The auction house is across the street from my home. I found this box loaded with negatives. I won it for $380.
The history of street photography is being rewritten.
Vivian Maier.
Vivian Maier.
Vivian Maier?
We've had more interest in this work than any other photographer.
There's one particular that I bought, which I love. The composition is slightly off to me, and I think that's why I like it.
Vivian was a very private woman.
She was so awesomely neat.
She was not an open person. She was a closed person.
Vivian was my nanny.
Yeah, she was our nanny.
He certainly had no idea she took photographs.
She was such a great artist, and her work was so amazing, and her story was so compelling. It was really satisfying to work on the film. It was a pretty small group of us that made the film. I would say maybe 10 people or less in the core group that were actually making the film. But I guess it just goes to show that, you know, if you're really passionate about a project, even with limited resources, you can do something that can kind of get out there in a larger way.
They didn't know there was this creative person there.
She took so many photos.
Around 100,000 negatives, 700 rolls of undeveloped color film, 8mm and 16mm movies.
She would take us and we would just walk in the worst parts of town, and I think she liked that.
I'm uncovering an artist. If I'm leaving this giant boulder unturned, it would be a mistake.
Seeing it get nominated for the Oscar was pretty exciting. But the main thing about that was that it really helped the film find a larger audience. A lot more people saw the film because of that, and a lot more people were exposed to Vivian Maier's work, which is obviously the most important thing.
As she was photographing, she was seeing just how close you can come into somebody's space. That tells me a lot about her. She could generate this moment, and then she's gone.
How do festivals like Indie Memphis and the International Film Festival help out the indie filmmakers?
Yeah, film festivals are fantastic because, you know, filmmakers make films to show them to people. And film festivals help films that, you know, are outside of the mainstream a little bit or not big budget blockbusters. They help those films to find an audience. And also, you know, films are made to be seen in a theater. That's the ideal space. I mean, it's great that iTunes exist, but movies are made to be seen and watched with people, a big group of people in the dark, in a theater together, sort of a communal experience. So film festivals provide that opportunity for films to be seen in that type of venue, a place that they might not otherwise get a chance to be shown.
That was filmmaker and GHS alum Chris McKinley talking about independent filmmaking on a national level. Here to talk about regional filmmaking is Melissa Sweezy, Director of the Department of Signs and Magical Interventions.
Thank you for joining us today.
Thanks for having me.
I'd like you to start us off with a definition. What does it mean to be an independent filmmaker?
To be an independent filmmaker, I guess in the classical sense, means that you have a very limited budget. You definitely have a lot of spirit, and you have talent, and you have a script, but often you're having to track down the funds.
How do independent filmmakers typically start out?
In terms of the career or a particular project, or?
It could be either. You could start off by telling us about the career.
Well, I think like a lot of people, like I knew this is what I wanted to do from a very early age. And it's only until recently, it's been a process that I think a lot of people have access to now because of cell phones, because of easy editing equipment on your laptop. So half of it is access. And then it is the advent of Kickstarter and Indiegogo and sites like that that help connect you to a wider audience to get funding and to start making movies.
Ms. Sweezy, you've seen quite a lot of success yourself. Talk to us about the success of your film, The Department of Signs and Magical Interventions. You wrote and directed it?
I did. It's been a really wonderful journey. I wrote the script, and it went on to win at a lot of different film festivals around the country, and that afforded me a lot of great opportunities to travel and meet a lot of filmmakers. And I kept getting a lot of encouragement from everyone that you need to make this film, you need to direct it. But at that point, I was just a screenwriter, or maybe just a screenwriter. And I was ready to direct, but I didn't want to learn on that one, because I felt like I didn't want to go to film school on that one, so I wrote a smaller project, directed that one, and then I got the courage up to finally direct The Department of Signs.
Well, we actually have a clip of that film, so let's take a look.
Please, show me a sign.
Welcome to the Department of Signs and Magical Interventions.
Someone asks for a sign, it's our job to approve or deny.
You're dead.
Vanessa Miles was supposed to obtain her engineering degree and go on to develop a very important water purification system for third world countries. She's now going to move for her fiancé's job, have three kids, and die of a stroke while training for the Chicago Marathon.
What did they say?
They're sending you back.
Going back will make me undead?
Is that a dragonfly?
Yeah, dragonflies are kind of my, good luck charm. Do you need to take that?
I can call back.
This is the film that actually won you a luncheon with the famous director David O. Russell. How was that experience?
That experience was, I think, kind of a movie in itself. It's the Nantucket Film Festival, and they have an amazing screenwriting competition. And the Department of Signs was runner-up. And so the prize was to have lunch. But I had to get from Memphis to Nantucket in June. And after two canceled flights, a bus trip, and a ferry, I docked at Nantucket, and they said that the luncheon had ended. And I was devastated. And so the next morning, got my suitcase, was ready to go, and I ran into David O. Russell at the bookstore and had this amazing, lovely conversation that was so encouraging. And yeah, it was very unexpected, but ended up working out.
Ms. Sweezy, as an independent filmmaker, how did you find actors for your film?
I found most of them, I'd say 95% of them locally. The lead in Department of Signs was a guy out of LA, but I didn't know him until he had come to Memphis to be in a film here. Memphis is not lacking with talent, at the acting side and the crew side, on both sides of the camera. We have so many amazing people working here.
In 2013, John's Farm, the first film that you've ever directed, won the Best Hometown Narrative Short Award. How did that win change your career?
It gave me, I think most importantly, it just gave me courage and confidence to know that I was on the right path and just to be accepted and acknowledged by my fellow filmmakers. That was a fantastic feeling.
Well, as a filmmaker, your first film comes with a lot of realizations about the career path that you're going down. What were some of those challenges and obstacles for you?
Honestly, I decided I was never going to write an outdoor scene again. that was a huge challenge. It just helped me look at when I write to be pay more attention to the budget this time out on things that I had. It's one thing to be in the room creating the story and another thing to be on set and making it happen. So I felt like I learned so much from point A to point B with a first and second film.
Well, it was a pleasure talking with you today.
Thanks for having me.
It's time to take a short break. When we return, we'll be joined by Lakeithan Mason from On Location Memphis.
Hey, let me get that for you.
Everybody needs a helping out. That ain't what it's all about. Tell me what.
Thank you, young man.
No problem.
Courtesy. Pass it on.
I got it.
A message from the Foundation for a Better Life.
Thank you, dear.
You make me feel so young.
Think young. Pass it on.
You make me feel so spring.
GHS TV has a new website. You can now view any of our shows on our new media pages. Or check out the latest Wake Up Germantown or Red Devil postgame. As always, we're streaming live 24/7. Just visit ghstv.org today.
Welcome back to Crosstalk. On this week's show, we're discussing independent film festivals and the filmmakers they support. Earlier in the show, we talked with Executive Director of Indie Memphis, Ryan Watt, and independent filmmakers Chris McKinley and Melissa Sweezy. Joining us now is Lakeithan Mason, member of the board of directors at On Location Memphis. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
On Location Memphis has been around for quite a while. Could you tell us about the history of OLM?
Yes. On Location Memphis actually was formerly known as the Memphis International Film Festival. Started in 1999 by Mr. Michael Harwood. And 16 years later, we now have a new director, new president, Angela Green, who's an entertainment attorney here, that's based in the music and film industry. So we've been working, again, for 16 years. We're creating a new and exciting identity that merges film and music together. So our festival truly tries to embrace what Memphis is known as, is a music capital, right? Music USA, and many of the films, the short films, as well as the features that come into our domain typically fall within some type of music documentary or short documentary that celebrates music in a film format.
Mr. Mason, earlier in the show we talked with Executive Director Ryan Watt of Indie Film Festival. How does On Location Memphis compare with festivals like Indie Memphis?
Well, definitely Indie Memphis is one of our friendly partners, right? Some of the things that they do are phenomenal as it relates to education, making sure that filmmakers here locally and regionally are actually educated on what to do, what not to do, how to get distribution, how to properly promote your film. So we are partners many times in those efforts of educating local, regional, and national filmmakers, and also bringing filmmakers and distributors and directors here so that they know exactly how talented our city of Memphis is. So I think we're more of a partnership, and I think a unique standout for On Location Memphis definitely goes back to how we try to make sure that music is infused into our festival activities, along with the many short films throughout the year that occur. It just doesn't happen on Labor Day weekend, right? On Location doesn't just show up and have 4 days of films. We actually have lots of activities throughout the year to make sure that we're tied into Oscar pre-screenings, as well as many shorts that we show on a monthly basis.
Your mission is to educate and inspire local filmmakers. In what way do you think OLM accomplishes that goal?
I think, you said OLM?
OLM.
Yeah, I love the acronym. On Location Memphis inspires filmmakers, I believe, by bringing in those experts that they don't necessarily see in Memphis, but maybe from LA, maybe from Australia, maybe from Austria, maybe from Turkey, where we've had many guests that's come in. And that inspiration comes from knowledge, right? Being educated on how do I now get my film as a local Memphis filmmaker out to the world? How do I gain distribution? What's really important in making sure that my film goes to Sundance or goes to a larger festival to where there's an international audience that truly embraces everything that our Memphians are doing on a filmmaking basis? There's a lot of talent here, right?
Mr. Mason, how are the judges selected for the festivals like this?
Typically, the judges are notified, right? So as a board, we try to look for those filmmakers or those influencers that are critical in the business industry right now. And those judges are sought out via relationships, via their interest in Memphis, again, as well as their availability, right? They're busy people. So sometimes we have some hits, sometimes we have some misses. But all in all, at the end of the day, there's a special interest here in bringing judges, talented judges, with knowledge and information here to our Memphis market to make sure our community gets the same opportunities from a filmmaking standpoint as others.
Compared to other states like Georgia and Louisiana, Tennessee doesn't offer much incentive. How does On Location Memphis help Tennessee receive outside attention?
Well, there are incentives and grant programs that are coming to fold now in the state of Tennessee. So we try to make sure that our followers and the participants of On Location Memphis are well informed of those grants that are currently available. So we support that through workshops, through educational forums, and the ability to make sure that each of our participants are actually informed.
It was a pleasure talking with you today.
Thank you.
Thank you to all our guests who came on the show today. Remember, Crosstalk can be seen each week at 9:30 a.m. and 7 p.m. on Mondays, 9 a.m. and 7 p.m. Thursdays, and 7:30 p.m. on Sundays. For more information on our programming, please check us out on the web at ghstv.org, where we're streaming live 24 hours a day. You can also check us out on Facebook and Twitter. I'm Renee Mann from all of us at GHS TV. Thank you for watching Crosstalk, and I hope to see you again.